Hello and welcome to StudyIQ. In this video, I will explain two important topics to you. First is the non-performing assets. Second is the twin balance sheet problem. Now this will help you in your descriptive writing, in your interviews, in your GDPI, because these two are the most important topics, because these two are the biggest problems that the Indian banks are facing. So after you have watched this video, you will be in a very good position to answer any question if it arises from these two issues. Before I even start, you should be knowing what are these, right? So I will tell you some basic terms. So let's say this is a bank and this is you. Okay. So now what you generally do is that now the bank has money, and that money you will take from the bank. Now that means, you know, the bank has assets in the form of money. And once you take the money from the bank in the form of loan, you know, now it is incumbent upon you that you pay it back. So you have now a liability. Your liability is that you need to pay the money back to the bank. So that is a liability. But how will you pay interest? For that, you have to make some profit from the debt that you are under, because you have taken money from the bank. So that is why you need to do debt servicing. What is debt servicing? Debt servicing means that whatever is the debt or loan that you have taken from the bank, whatever is the debt you are under, you have to make some money from that. So that is called debt servicing. If you are not able to do debt servicing, how will you pay the money back to the bank with interest? Right? So this is the basic funda that you have to do debt servicing. Now let's say your company goes in loss. So what will happen? You will not be able to do debt servicing. That is, you will not be able to make money from the loan that you have taken from the bank. And then you will not be able to pay it back to the bank. And therefore the bank's money will sink. And the loan that bank has given to you, you will not be able to pay interest, and you will become a defaulter. So after you become a defaulter, bank will blacklist you, or bank will try to reach out to you because the loan might be in crores and thousands of crores, and bank will try its best to recuperate the money. Now, how can bank recuperate the money? So bank will give you a lot of options. For example, bank might waive off your interest, that at least the money will come back. Bank will try to do OTS, that is one time settlement. So for example, let's say you have taken a loan of 100 crore rupees. So bank will tell you, okay, pay just 100 crore and we don't want the interest. We don't want the 15% interest. So we are waiving off 15 crore rupees. So you will say, okay, I will pay 100 crore. Now let's say worst case, you are not able to pay 100 crore also. So bank will see that, okay, whatever is your collateral that is worth, let's say 50 crore rupees. So bank will not be able to recuperate the money, you know, even after selling your car and property and all that. Now, how you got so much money? That is another factor. That is another case. For your 50 crore assets, how are you able to get 100, you know, this much money? Because you have bribed the managers. That is what generally happens. So these big companies, what they do is they bribe the managers. And there are a lot of things in the gray. Like, it depends on the growth of the company, the outlook of the company, the balance sheet of the company, and so many things are in the gray. They depend upon the manager's wisdom. So they say that, okay, even if the company has less money, less collateral, it still is a growing company in the market and we will be able to recuperate. So the bank managers, they take money and they pass the loans and they get the kickbacks, they get the bribe. So bank will try to do one-time settlement. Then what can the bank do? Bank will then say, okay, instead of 100 crore, you pay 80 crore, one-time settlement. 80 crore pay cash and you are profiting in a way the interest, and 20 crore extra we have given you a waiver. So bank will try to do its best. Sometime what the bank can do is it can hire a asset reconstruction company, ARC. What is the meaning of ARC? So what asset reconstruction company is, the company, it will go to the bank and it will say to the bank that, I know you have your 100 crore rupees stuck with this person. Okay, he is not able to pay. So I will make sure that I will get this money from this person. What you do is you give me this 100 crore debt. Okay, I want to buy your debt. So asset reconstruction company, it buys the debt from the bank. So this asset reconstruction company will go to the bank. It will say, please sell your 100 crore debt to me for 50 crore. So banks will think, okay, I might not get anything from this person. He is, let's say, a Vijay Mallya type of person. I will not get, he will run away and this and that. At least I'm getting 50 crore. So it will sell its 100 crore debt to the to the asset reconstruction company. Now the asset reconstruction company has to get 50 crore minimum from this person, otherwise it will be in a loss. So asset reconstruction company will also try to do all the same things. It will try to get the money out of this person, give him offers of one-time settlement and try its best. Now the problem is, the asset reconstruction companies are also not able to get the money out of people. So you will ask me one question, why the bank initially agreed to have a loss of 50 crore? All these things which the asset reconstruction company is offering to the person, the same things bank can also offer to the person. No, one-time settlement and everything. Because asset reconstruction company has hired, you know, it's a group of person. Those persons can be hired by the bank to offer same things to the person. So why asset reconstruction company concept is gaining popularity, and why the asset reconstruction company are called bad loan banks? Because the banks, they have, you know, whatever was their responsibility, they have simply transferred it to asset reconstruction company, and already they have taken a hit. They had given a 100 crore loan and they have only got 50 crore. And even this, but banks will say, okay, something is better than nothing. So I will tell you the reason for that, why this is happening. Because India is compliant to Basel III norms. What is Basel III norms? Now you need to understand. Wait, let me clean this board. Yeah. So Basel III norms is that by 31st March 2019, that is financial year 2019, we have to be Basel III compliant. And Basel III stands on the fact of capital adequacy ratio. What is capital adequacy ratio? So I will tell you in very, very simple terms. So how, you know, basically Basel is the name of a place in Switzerland. Okay, it is pronounced Basel. Some say call it Basel also. So let's say Basel. Basel III, Basel is a place in Switzerland where the all the financial organizations of the world, they met. And basically they met for three times, Basel I, Basel II, Basel III. And basically the purpose was one, that is protect the people. Protect the banks and protect the people. So if a bank turns fraud, then how will the people be protected? And also the banks need to be protected. So for that, what have they suggested is that banks have to have a capital adequacy ratio. For example, let's say there is a bank and this capital adequacy ratio is 12.5%. So let's say there is a bank of 1000 crore rupees assets. Okay. Now what will bank do of its assets? It has to give loan to the public, no? So the bank will try to give this 1000 crore rupees to the public. Now what the RBI has done is that to protect the public interest, RBI has said that you cannot give the entire 1000 crore because you have to maintain SLR and CRR. So CRR 4% you have to keep with me. Okay, so 40 crores you need to keep with me. And SLR also, which I think is more than 20% now. So SLR also you need to invest in government securities. So, and the remaining you can give as loan, we don't mind. Why RBI has done this is because, let's say if somebody takes a loan and he wants the loan back. So the bank has 1000 crore rupees, it which completely gives away all the loan. And then somebody comes and asks, somebody has put assets in the bank, right? Because there are two sides of the coin. Bank will give loan also and bank will have deposits also. So let's say I'm a person, I have deposited 50 crore rupees in the bank. And you know, that was a part of this 1000 crore assets of the bank. My 50 crore also. Now I want this 50 crore back. So can the bank tell me that no, I have given all the money as loan and now I don't have any money to pay you back? This should not happen. That is why RBI insists that to protect the interest of the consumer, SLR and CRR have to be maintained. But important thing to understand here is that, you know, the CRR and SLR is also your money only. See, a bank has opened, okay? Bank has been opened and people deposit money in the bank and that has converted into 1000 crore. Now, bank is putting SLR, bank is putting CRR, but even this SLR and CRR is also your money only, right? It is a part of this 1000 crore deposits. So what capital adequacy demands is that you know, whatever the security that you provide to the consumer, whatever the bank security bank has to provide, it has to be its own. So that tomorrow if the bank goes bankrupt, then some money can be, you know, given back to the consumer. So if it is 1000 crore, then 12.5% of that is 125 crore rupees has to be bank's own money, not public's money, because this 40 crore rupees CRR is public's money. SLR, whatever is the rate right now, that is also public's money, but 125 crore, 12.5% has to be your own money. Okay, so how will this asset reconstruction company help? So asset reconstruction company is simply a way of the government to show that the bank is in good shape, because when the bank, it gives its all the bad loans to the asset reconstruction company, its bad loans decrease, which makes the bank look good, and therefore bank becomes Basel III compliant. And this ARC, you know, this is not a part of banking, but rather government can show it as non-banking financial company. Therefore Basel III norms, they will only see how the banks are doing. So if we simply transfer the bank's bad things to another company, we become Basel III compliant, and that is why it is a kind of fraud that the government is doing. And every government does it, every country does it. They somehow try to shift the burden of bad loans from the bank to some other companies. They can be asset reconstruction companies or the other types of companies in other countries. So that is why asset reconstruction company is simply a way to become Basel III compliant. Otherwise banks also have all the checks and balances to get the money out of people, and if the person does not pay, then a bank, it's very little that the bank can do. And same is with ARC. All those mechanisms which are available to the bank, same faculties are available to the asset reconstruction company also. So it is simply the bank's bad loans, they become now ARC's headache, and banks, they look very, very good. Oh, we have no bad loans, because it is the ARC that has taken those bad loans. So it is just a way. And when the ARC is not able to get the money out from that defaulter, then the government, what it does is it infuses money into the ARC, and that is taxpayers' money. So ultimately, the, you know, these defaulters, they are serviced by our money. So I hope now you have understood the entire thing, what is happening, what is asset reconstruction company, and what is this fraud, and what is Basel III compliant. Now, what is twin balance sheet problem? Let me rub the board again. So there is a bank, and there is a Mallya type of guy. Okay. He is having this Kingfisher bottle. He is drinking. Now, let's say this is a bank, and this is a Mallya type guy. So the bank, you know, its assets will be with these so many guys, n number of guys. So bank has given loan. It is not getting the loan back into the bank. So what will happen? The bank's assets will keep on decreasing with time, right? And the liabilities of these people will keep on increasing with time. So the main problem here is that the bank's assets are decreasing with time, and therefore the bank's viability is decreasing. Bank's liquidity is decreasing. So even those people who return the loans back to the bank, bank will not be able to service those people because its assets are low. That is the problem that is called twin balance sheet problem. That is decrease in the assets of bank on repayment, non-repayment of loans. And that is how the banks die. They literally die. So to protect these banks, see, if it is a private bank, then no problem. But if it's a public sector bank, the onus lies on the government to put the assets back. Otherwise, how will this bank function? So let's say there is a bank, 1000 crore. It has given out 500 crore rupees, and out of that 500, only 100 crore has come back and 400 has drowned. Now the bank's asset is what? Only 600 crore, 500 plus 100 that has come back, 600 crore. So now the bank's assets will be 600 crore. So what the government will do, it will infuse further 400 crore to make the bank liquid and viable. So that is how they are solving the twin balance sheet problem. But we will take a look in depth, in detail, about the twin balance sheet problem and why this happens and why non-performing assets are accumulated. What is the origin of the problem? We will do it in depth. So let's start. Now you are at a good level to understand the things that I explained to you. So what is a non-performing asset? So basically we say that if a bank has given a loan to someone, and on 30 days, if nothing has come back, no interest, nothing, no repayment, no tranche, then it is a bad loan. And if it extends to 90 days, then it is a non-performing assets. So non-performing asset, it refers to a classification of loans in the books of the financial institution that are in default or in arrears on scheduled payments of principal or interest. So for 90 days, if no principal has come back or no interest has come back, then it is a non-performing asset. So SURFICE Act, in most cases, debt is classified as non-performing when the loan payments have not been made for 90 days. Now in February 2016, RBI did a asset quality review. That is, what is the assets that are with the bank, okay? And do you think the assets were more or less? That was when we finally found out. In fact, it has been going on for long, but in the asset quality reviews, whenever RBI does it, we always find the assets of the banks are going down. That is, the twin balance sheet problem is increasing. So they found out in February 2016 that the public sector banks reported that non-performing assets have soared to such an extent, they have increased to such an extent that provisioning for bad loans had affected the operating earnings. As a result, net income had plunged so low. So this is what I was telling you, the assets of the bank, they have become so low that the loan giving capacity or the lending capacity of the bank has reduced so much. That is why their earnings will affect, even if the people gave the money back, but the bank is giving out less money. So less earnings, of course. So the net income of the banks had also decreased. This is what RBI found in the asset quality review. In fact, more than 4/5 of the non-performing assets were in the public sector banks. Because public sector banks, it is very easy. There is no loyalty to of the managers. They are only answerable to the government and they are at a very high position. So nobody can question them and they can give out the loans in the interest of the bank. That is what they say. So in the private banks, there is a chairman, you know, and I mean, his life is always on the line. And so he keeps a track of what his managers are doing. But in public sector banks, the checks and balances are very, very low. So the non-performing asset ratio had reached almost 12%. 12% is very, very large. So this news in February 2016, it set off alarm bells among investors, who responded by fleeing public sector bank shares, bringing their prices to such low levels that at one point, the medium-sized private sector bank HDFC, it is not even a very big bank compared to ICICI, but still a very big bank. But the medium-sized private HDFC bank was valued as much as 24 public sector banks put together. So out of the 27 public sector banks that we have, 24 public sector banks had the same value as one HDFC bank alone. And let me tell you that HDFC bank is still not that big a bank that, you know, but why did it happen? Because the investors, they started selling their shares because the banks were making losses. So they could have made more losses in the future. Sensing that, the investors started selling their public sector bank shares. And that is why when you sell the shares in the open market, then of course the price decreases. But if you buy the shares of a company in the open market, then the price of share increases because demand of the share is increasing. So Credit Suisse, the company, reported that around 40% of the corporate debt it monitored was owed by companies which had an interest coverage ratio less than 1, meaning they did not earn enough to pay the interest obligations on their loans, which means what? They were not able to do debt servicing, which means that all these big companies like the steel company, like the infrastructure companies, they take big loans from the banks and they are not able to earn money. That is, they are not able to do debt servicing, and that is why they were not able to pay the interest obligations on their loans. That was reported by Credit Suisse. So higher costs, lower revenues, and greater financing cost all squeezed the corporate cash flow quickly, leading to debt servicing problems. Right? Now you've understood it? I repeat, higher cost, lower revenue, greater financing cost all squeezed the corporate cash flow. This is with regard to company. Companies had very high cost, no? They have so many expenditures and all, and their revenue is very less. They are not able to do debt servicing. So that is why they are not able to pay to the bank. By 2013, this is some other data that I'm sharing with you, which will be very handy for your essay. Nearly 1/3 of the corporate debt was owed by companies with an interest coverage ratio less than 1. Interest coverage ratio is what? Less than 1. And we just named it IC1 companies for writing sake, in short, you know. And many of them are in the infrastructure, like the metal sector, power generation. These are the companies which have huge debt. For example, the power distribution companies. You already know, government has started UDAY scheme. Why? Because the power distribution companies had a debt of, you know, lakhs of crores of rupees. Lakhs of crores, not even thousands of crores, lakhs of crores. So these are some companies which were in heavy debt. By 2015, the share of these companies which were not making, which had an interest coverage ratio of less than 1, the companies which were performing worse, their share reached nearly 40%, as slowing growth in China caused international steel prices to collapse, causing nearly every Indian steel company to record large losses. And if you remember, the Tata Steel also, it was making heavy losses, and they had bought a company, Corus Steel, in Europe also, and which turned out to be a bad decision, and I mean, all the steel companies, you know, every steel company, because there was a slow growth in China, and because of that, the steel prices, they collapsed. Now, the government responded very quickly by imposing import prices, while international prices themselves recovered somewhat, thereby affording the steel industry some relief. But even then, the IC1 share, that is the companies whose interest coverage was less than 1%, their share remained above 40% in the late 2016. This is very, very latest. So it became very clear that India was suffering from a twin balance sheet problem. Okay, because of which companies? Steel companies, metal companies, mainly infrastructure companies. Why they were suffering from twin balance sheet problem? Because the companies were taking the money, they were not giving the money back to the bank. So the assets of the bank were decreasing. So when the bank has less money, it will give less loan, and therefore it will have less earning, less interest. So that is the twin balance sheet problem. And because of that, what happened was the banking is also collapsing and the corporate sector is also collapsing, because corporate sector is under heavy debt. And why the bank is collapsing? Because bank is collapsing because its assets are decreasing, so it is not able to make money. Both are under stress. So that is the twin balance sheet problem. Twin means what? Two. Both are suffering. At this current level, India's non-performing asset ratio is higher than any other major emerging market, with the exception of Russia. Now see, Russia has its own problem, because Russia is not very good relation right now with America and European Union. So they have imposed economic sanctions because of Russia's war with Ukraine and Crimea, and America, with the help of EU, because International Monetary Fund and the other one, the World Bank, the Bretton Woods twins, they are dominated by the European Union and America. So they have put economic sanctions on Russia. What is the meaning of economic sanctions? Russia will not be able to trade in dollars. So every country trades in dollars, but then for getting the country's currency convert from dollar to the same currency, it has to go back to US. So if US says no, then the country is in big trouble. So that is why USA is the major power in the world, because dollar is the reserve currency for most of the countries. I'll give an example what I'm saying. Let's say India is trading with Pakistan. So Indian currency is different, Pakistan currency is different, no? So which currency they will trade in? Indian currency or the Pakistan currency? So they will trade in dollars, because that is a common currency. But so let's say India does a business of, export from to Pakistan of $100 million. But this $100 million is of no use to India, no? It has to go back to USA and it has to get rupees in exchange, because dollar will work in USA. It is a reserve currency. So it is the currency of USA. So India will have to get back rupees from USA. If USA says no, I will not take the currency back, so what will India do of these dollars? So same is happening with Russia. So Russia has been put under economic sanctions by the America and the EU. So their non-performing assets are suffering, increasing, their banks are suffering, their economy is suffering. In fact, the currency of Russia, which is ruble, it has been on a steady decline. And India's non-performing assets are even higher than Korea during the East Asian crisis. So problem is worse. Now, why is India problem different from that of other countries? For example, the twin balance sheet problem that India is facing, is it different from other countries? So I'll explain it to you. So typically, countries have a twin balance sheet problem. They follow a standard path. What is that standard path? Now, before you read this text, I will make it simple for you. What is this standard path? So what happens is, whenever there is a boom, let's say I have an IT company. Okay. So IT company is worth 100 crore rupees. And there is an IT boom now. So I will try to take advantage of the boom, and I will try to spread my company. I will take it overseas, and I will spread its branches across India. For that, I will need money. Okay. And there are banks. So I will go to the bank and I will say, please give me money. So now please note that this is only an analogical case. I'm not going very technical. Otherwise, you will not understand these things. I'm making it very simple for you. So my company is ABC IT company. So it goes to the bank. Bank asked me, what is your worth? I say, I have 100 crore rupees. Out of that, I have 50 crore cash. And rest are my immovable assets, property and building and everything, car and all. So bank will say, okay, I will give you a loan of, let's say, 100 crore rupees. So I will tell to the bank that this is a boom right now. So I need more money. And when, because I will take advantage of the boom, I will make more money and later I can give you. So please give me more than my capacity. So bank says, okay, because this is in the gray area, no, bank has to take many things into consideration. So the bank will also say, okay, there is a boom right now. And yeah, this company is right. Let's give him the money because it is IT boom. So bank will give me 1000 crore rupees, knowing the fact that I cannot repay this if I turn a defaulter, but still they will give me because it is a boom time right now. Now, but this boom goes, this was a manufactured boom or whatever, there was a bust, okay, IT bust. There is a, you know, the country is under stagflation. All of a sudden it is under recession. Recession means GDP growth is less. Something like that happens. Now this 1000 crore rupees will drown. It will sink. That is what usually creates the twin balance sheet problem. What the banks do is during the boom time, you know, they let the corporations overexpand. So the corporations overexpand during the boom time, leaving them with the obligation that they cannot repay if something goes wrong. And most of the time it goes wrong because all of these booms, we have seen IT boom, we have seen all the types of boom. They just boom, you know, like that. So what happens basically is that the, you know, the banks, they are overactive. They are proactive. They give a lot of loans. And banks also think that, okay, this guy will make a lot of money and he will give back. And also these bank managers, especially of public sector banks, they have targets that you have to give in this month 10,000 crore of loan. Otherwise, you are not a good manager. You are not able to convince companies and bring companies on board, and you are causing losses to the banks. And so bank managers are always very, very active, and they are proactive in shelling out the loans, provided the company is good. And who will determine the company's good? It is the bank managers only. And that leaves a lot of room for corruption. So they default on their debt, leaving bank balance sheets impaired. Now you've understood. When the boom goes or when the boom collapses, then the debt will not be able to be repaid. And that is what causes the twin balance sheet problems. So this is the standard path that happens in the every country. And this is what exactly happened in the Asian financial crisis in 97-98 and in the 2008 recession in the US and the UK. That is the global financial crisis. In fact, it got so worse in US that all the big banks in America, all the big banks, they crashed. Their assets were like, I mean, their assets had collapsed because all the assets were, you know, given to the companies during the boom times. But this is not what happens in India's case. However, this happens, but not to this extent. So India had boomed during the mid 2000s along with the global economy, because the recession of 2008 also affected India. But it was not as worse, you know, because RBI puts a lot of checks and balances on the bank. So India was still saved to some extent, you know, because of recession. So India's recession, you can say, was still controlled compared to other countries, although still India was in recession. Yes, in fact, let me tell you, India's recession was not as worse, because it's just that the Indian companies, they found it as an excuse for cost cutting, you know, to lay off the useless people in the company. They said, oh, it's recession, so we need to lay off people. Now they found it as an excuse for cost cutting and for hiring at a low salary. That was also being said. Anyways, so India's recession was not as worse. In fact, even during the 2008 year, our GDP was growing at a world beating pace. So it was different to other countries because of the checks and balances by the Reserve Bank of India. And yeah, that's all you need to know. So according to conventional wisdom, that is what is being said, that is called conventional wisdom. India's economy survived. Why? Because Indian companies and banks had avoided the boom period mistakes made by their counterparts abroad. That is, the banks, yes, they were active. I remember that when the IT boom came, you know, banks were giving loans to IT companies, but then the loans that were given to IT companies were not of the order that the European banks and the American banks were shelling out. So India is still a conservative country, and that conservative kind of behavior is seen even by the banks. So Indian economy survived. That is what is being said, according to conventional wisdom is being said. So more precisely, in this view, they were prevented from accumulating too much leverage because prudential restrictions kept the bank credit from expanding excessively during the boom, while capital controls prevented an undue recourse to foreign loans. So all this you can write in your answer. However, contrary to conventional wisdom, now there is a flip side to this also. India did follow the standard path to some extent to the twin balance sheet problem. So I told you the bank still gave loans that caused twin balance sheet problem in India also, but still it was much less compared to European counterparts. So what distinguished India from other countries was the consequences of twin balance sheet. So in other twin balance sheet cases, growth was derailed because high non-performing asset levels had triggered banking crisis. But this did not happen in India. Even as India balance sheets have suffered structural damage on the order of what has occurred in crisis cases, the impact of growth has been quite modest. And twin balance sheet did not lead to economic stagnation as occurred in America and Europe after the global financial crisis and Japan after its bubble burst in the 1990s. So this is all the text that you can write in your answers. I have explained to you. I don't think merely reading the text will add more. But mention these words that India developed its own unique version of twin balance sheet. What last year's economic survey called a balance sheet syndrome with Indian characteristics. So you know our balance sheet syndrome, it is very different from that of the European and American system. So India's exceptional experience may be owed in part to the unusual structure of its banking system, which ensured there would be no financial crisis. Why our banking system in India is said to be very, very so-called recession resistant. That is, it's not very easy to make our banks bankrupt. Because of non-performing assets and corruption, it is going bankrupt. But otherwise, we are very, very sharp people in banking. So in fact, the banking system did not feel at any point that the twin balance sheet is causing it a problem. One reason might be because see our banks, the money that is there in the banks, it is still in the order of lakhs of crores of rupees, the public sector banks. People still trust the public sector banks more and they put a lot of money in the public sector banks. So that is why the twin balance sheet problem, it does not occur beyond a point, because even if the banks, they lose, let's say 20% assets in twin balance sheet, because of TBS problem, still the money is more. So, but now it keeps on accumulating over time. And now it is only now that we have realized that NPAs have gone out of control. And Reserve Bank of India and the government, they have tried everything in their part. They have tried all the types of schemes. They have tried SARFAESI, making SARFAESI more robust, more strong. They have tried S4A structure. They have tried corporate debt restructuring. They have tried everything. But the non-performing assets are just growing and growing. In fact, Reserve Bank of India is also taking prompt corrective action. And there is a joint lenders forum also. What is a joint lenders forum? See, in a joint lenders forum, the bank is able to, the bank is able to get the warning signs. So there is a division of the stress assets. Like for example, incipient stress. That is, there are signs that this account may go wrong. So banks, they put a red mark on that okay, we will observe this person more now. That happens in joint lenders forum. But banks, Reserve Bank of India is also taking prompt corrective action. In fact, now there are 6 banks against which the prompt corrective action has been initiated in this very year in 2017. 6 banks. So I will tell you what is prompt corrective action later on. So India and China, there are some similarities in the non-performing assets, and because India's path resembled that of China, you know, although to a much smaller scale, since India's bad loans are just 1/7 the amount assessed for China. In China also, there is a lot of problem of non-performing assets because both countries, they provide generous amounts of bank financing to allow highly levered corporations to survive. But these highly levered corporations suddenly become low levered corporations. And then they drown, putting the bank in a bigger risk. So this problem, again, you can read about it. The origin of problem, it started in the 2000s, and economies all over the world were booming, and no country more than India was booming. GDP growth was almost 9 to 10%. So the first time in India's history, everything was going right. Corporate profitability was among the highest in the world, you know, encouraging the banks to give more and more loans. So it seemed like India had finally arrived, you know. In 1991, India became liberalized, no? It opened its doors to the world. It became liberalized. And in 2000s, we thought that India has finally arrived because our GDP was still growing by 9 to 10%. And but then things started going wrong. Firms, they accordingly launched new projects worth lakhs of crores to reach out to the infrastructure related company like power generation, steel, telecom. So this is some of the background that I am giving. Why the steel, telecom, power generation, these companies have completely made the bank suffer. In fact, right now, all the telecom companies are suffering because there's a telecom boom in India, no? Telecom boom means what? Like earlier, if you used to do one call, the money that you had to pay was around 15 rupees. And now it is only 15 paisa or something. It is very less now. So that is a telecom boom. 70 crore, 80 crore mobile phones you have in India, more than 1 billion connections. And therefore, it is a telecom boom. So what caused this telecom boom? The telecom companies, they want to spread all across India. And therefore, telecom companies will take lakhs of crores of loan from the bank. And banks will also happily give it, right? And now what is happening? I just read 10 days back that Arundhati Bhattacharya, who is the chairman of SBI, she is saying that the government needs to bail out the telecom companies because telecom companies, they have accumulated losses of thousands of crores, all the telecom companies in India, and there are not many. It is an oligopolistic market. There are less sellers and more buyers. So and whose money is that? That is taxpayers' money. In other words, it is just a transfer of profit. That's all. The government is giving profit to telecom companies for nothing. And when the government wants to bail out the farmers, it is always a huge issue. But when it wants to bail out the companies, it is never a problem. So within the span of 4 short years, the investment is to GDP ratio had soared by 11 percentage points, reaching over 38% by 2007-2008. And this investment was financed by astonishing credit boom, the largest in India's history. So, in fact, India, it got its footing wrong. And in the span of just 3 years, running from 2004 to 2008, the amount of non-food bank credit, it doubled. And this was just the credit from banks. There were also large inflows of funding from overseas also, with capital inflows in 2007-08 reaching 9% of the GDP. And all of this added up an extraordinary increase in the debt of non-banking, non-financial corporation. So this was the genesis of the problem. I'll not go into too much depth in this. You can just read. I've explained very, very lucidly here. And the financing cost of the companies also increased. The, RBI, because what RBI did was RBI increased the interest rate to decrease the inflation. Whenever RBI will decrease the repo rate, what will happen? Inflation will increase along with the growth. So RBI, what it did was RBI increased the rate. And because of that, inflation went down, but the cost of the companies became more. Financing cost increased because for all those companies which had hired from the local banks. So this is a further genesis of the problem that companies that sought financial accommodation from their creditors asking for principal payment to be postponed on the ground that if the projects were given sufficient time, they would eventually prove viable. Now see what happened. Now the bank started realizing, oh, what have we done? This is post 2008. Banks started thinking, what have we done? So they started asking companies to give money back. But the company said that, look, boom is going on. Please give us more time. So banks gave more time and they started giving time to time extensions to the companies, thinking that eventually the companies will become viable because the demand was commensurate to the boom. In a boom, there is always a huge demand of the products and services of the company. And that was the genesis of the problem. So our stressed assets, they started increasing and finally they became the non-performing assets. And so now you have some idea about the non-performing assets and what led to the twin balance sheet problem. You can surely write now in your exam. That's what I believe. And these are some facts which you want to include. What is right now the non-performing assets in the order of what? What percentage of GDP? They have crossed 6 lakh crore. Now they are 9 lakh crore. They are reaching 12 lakh crores. And which banks are facing prompt corrective action? What is going wrong? Why the government is not able to check corruption in the banks? So all these things you can mention in your essay. Now, a financing strategy, it needs to be sustainable. But for that to happen, there are some scenarios they say that they can help. Like, for example, there is a Phoenix scenario in which accelerating growth would gradually raise the cash flow of stressed company, eventually allowing them to service their debt. So this is like a positive scenario. That is Phoenix. Phoenix means what? Rising from the ashes. That is, the companies will eventually make profit and they will be able to do debt servicing and therefore pay back to the banks. And there is something known as a containment scenario. That is, the non-performing asset would merely need to be limited in nominal terms. Once this is done, they would swiftly shrink as a share of the economy and a proportion of the bank balance sheet, since GDP is growing at a nominal rate of more than 10%. So basically what they are saying is, like the government is saying, that the, you know, the states, they will have a revenue loss, but that will be compensated by the increased growth. So the increased rate of growth of the banks will eventually compensate the non-performing asset. What does it actually mean? It means that, see, more people are coming into banking now. So more people will deposit the money into the banks. And therefore, the bank's balance sheet, the bank's assets will increase. So now, let's say even if earlier 10% were the non-performing asset of the bank, now they become 20% also, still the remaining share has become much larger. So the banks will think that, okay, because of the growth, the good GDP growth and the good growth of the banking sector, we can still take care of the non-performing asset. That is what you call the containment scenario. So that is a relative scenario. That is, the growth will offset the non-performing asset. And this they have explained more about, for some years, the financing strategy worked in the sense that it has allowed India to grow rapidly, despite a significant twin balance sheet problem. But this strategy is now reaching its limits. And who are affected by this twin balance sheet problem? So stress has expanded to the telecom sector, where interest coverage ratio has deteriorated as a new entry has increased competition, prompting a major round of price cutting. In short, stress on the corporate sector is not only deepening, it is also widening. Now, what is the meaning of this? So I'll tell you what is the meaning of this. Let's say I am Bharti Airtel. Okay, now what is the problem with me? So in India came the telecom boom. Now what happened was, when the telecom boom came, I took a loan of lakhs of crores from the banks, because I wanted to expand to entire India. I wanted to give cheap call rates to the public. And because of that, I gained significant market share. Today, if you see, Bharti Airtel has a significant market share in India, in both internet and telecom, I mean, everything, the 4G and everything. So now they said to the bank, we will become profitable in the next 10 years because now our burn rate will be more. We will spend now to gain the market share, but eventually we will become sustainable. Now what has happened is, when their time came to earn profits, now Jio has come. And Jio has called what is called a disruptive, it has disrupted the market. Disruptive revolution. That is, it has, because they have very deep pockets, Jio has been launched at a worst time that could be for the companies. Because that was the time now finally to earn profits after you have gained the market share. And finally to do debt servicing and finally to pay to the banks. So now what has happened is, Jio has disrupted the market. It is not letting these companies increase the prices of calls and other services to make money, because it has decreased the prices so much. So now the companies have two options. One is to keep the prices similar and keep losing the market share. And second is to keep the prices low and face the brunt of the banks. I mean, that is why the telecom sector right now is collapsing. It has reached its limits. Twin balance sheet is also taking a heavy toll on the health of the public sector banks also. So banks around the world, they typically strive for a return of assets of 1.5% or above. That is the norm which is followed around the world. But Indian public sector banks are much below this international norm. That is, the return on assets is not 1.5% or above, it is below. In fact, let me tell you, the return on assets on public sector banks has been negative for the past 2 years. As a result, investors are no longer willing to pay full price for public sector bank shares. See, if the return on investment is less, who will buy the shares of public sector bank? Nobody will invest. So investors are not buying. Even if they are buying, they are not willing to pay full price. Their share value has fallen to just 2/3 of their book value. The share prices are falling of the banks. So their assets in any case are decreasing. So public sector banks, they have responded to this difficult financial situation in the standard way. They have tried to protect their capital position by minimizing the new risk they are taking. That is, by scaling back their new lending. Some of the lending slack has been taken up by the private bank, but there are limits to the extent that they can provide a substitute, because the public sector banks are much larger. As a result, total credit to the corporate sector has been declining or decelerating steadily. In real terms, such credit growth is now negative, the lowest it has been in 23 years. You understood what is written here. See, the thing is, public sector banks are more in number, no? And they have bigger cash pool compared to the private banks. So the private banks are, even they are facing this problem, because public sector banks, what they are trying is damage control. Public sector banks are trying damage control means what? They are trying to decrease their lending. They are scaling down their lending. And the private banks, what are they doing is, they are a competition to the public sector banks. Because what is happening is this. So I met a bank manager of SBI. He is a general manager of SBI Patiala. He told me SBI is facing the biggest competition from ICICI Bank. And I asked how. So one is obviously the cash pool in ICICI is huge, comparable to SBI. But more importantly, even if a public sector banks wants to decrease the lending, it cannot, because the companies will then go to the private banks. So public sector banks eventually will diminish if they transfer their customers to the private banks. And also because of the FDI and other things, because of more liberal economy, there are also a lot of foreign banks in India now, which are willing to give loans to the companies. So even if you try to do damage control, even if you try to reduce your lending, you still can't do it at a very heavy level, because there are private banks which are a substitute, which are an alternative for the companies. And therefore, the economy is now facing the brunt, and agriculture loans, another problem. Agriculture loans problem is that banks cannot decrease their agriculture loan. See, this is another problem. The banks, they have to give priority sector lending. So for example, agriculture, for example, MSME, they are all part of the priority sector lending. So even if the agriculture loans are a huge source of losses to the bank, they still can't do away without it. They still can't stop it, because that is a part of the priority sector lending. These are the instructions by the Reserve Bank of India, by the government of India, that you have to first give loans priority to the agriculture sector, MSME sector, all the priority sectors. That is another problem, Let me give you another example. Household credit, where default has been minimal and where private sector banks have a comparative lending advantage, has been expanding exceptionally rapidly, fueling the growth of consumption. So this is another example, housing sector. Next. How much progress has been made on the 4R agenda? What is 4R agenda, that you need to understand? See, 4R agenda is that economic survey of 2015-16. It had emphasized four ways by which we can address this problem. See, when you write your essay, you have to also include the solution. Okay, everybody says this is the problem, that is the problem, but what is the solution? So they said that these are the solution: reform, recognition, recapitalization, and resolution. This was said, but again, very less progress has been made. So let me give you the example. First, let's talk about reform. What are the reforms in the banking sector? So very less progress has been made in this regard. So you can read more about it here, that once the balance sheet problem is resolved, there could be significant moral hazard problems. Newly cleaned up balance sheets may simply encourage bank managers to lend freely, ignoring the lessons of the past. So basically what they are saying is, first, the balance sheet problem is still there. And even if the balance sheet problem stops, then the banks will think that, okay, balance sheet problem is temporary. Now we will give even more loans. We will make even more profit. They will not learn from their lesson. And structural reforms, which are aimed at preventing balance sheet problem, can take many forms, but serious consideration must also be given to the issue of government majority ownership in the public sector banks. So one problem is that the governments own most of the stakes in the public sector bank, and that is what make the banks ill-disciplined. So there should be some private collaboration or private public partnership. Government should divest some of the stake in the public sector banks, make it private, because once private players comes, they streamline the entire process. So reforms have been very, very less. Most of the progress has been made in the second R, which is the recognition. What is recognition? That is RBI's asset quality review. We have recognized the problem. Banks have recognized a growing number of loans as non-performing. So banks will need to be recapitalized. That is the third R. So we have tried the Indradhanush scheme, and we are putting money into the banks. But again, that is not a permanent problem. You put more money into the bank, and that money will also be eventually loaned out to the people, and then again that will be a twin balance sheet problem. So how much money can you put? And it is the public taxpayers' money. Eventually public's patience will also run out. So recapitalization is really not a big solution. And the key issue is the fourth, which is resolution of loans. So even I told you, even if the public sector banks are recapitalized, they are unlikely to increase their lending until they truly know the losses they will suffer on the bad loans. So again, I mean, it's the same thing that, you know, been there, done there, deja vu effect. It will be very difficult for the banks to give out loans, number one. Or if they give out loans, then again, there is a problem. They will suffer the same problem of non-performing assets increase. So that is the problem. And nor will the large stressed borrowers be able to increase their investment until their financial positions have been rectified. So again, if somebody is a defaulter and you are paying more loan to the guy so that he can finally use that money to come out of his miserable position, there is no guarantee. In fact, your non-performing asset might increase more. The willful defaulter will, you know, he might not return the extra money also back, and nor his fortunes can change overnight. So economic growth will remain under threat. Now, I told you about prompt corrective action. This RBI is taking, it has initiated against 6 banks. In that, the RBI is putting restrictions on the bank. So there are restrictions, and like, for example, it can stop branch expansion of a bank. It can tell the bank you cannot expand more, you cannot open more branches. It can stop dividend payment, that is sharing the profit with the bank. Then it can also put a restriction on the bank's lending capacity. These are all some prompt corrective actions. PCA, when it is invoked, when the risk threshold is breached. For example, when the non-performing assets, they increase to such a level that the RBI is forced to intervene. So there are two types of sanctions in prompt corrective action, mandatory and discretionary. Restrictions on dividend, that is profit sharing, branch expansion, and director's compensation are mandatory, while discretionary restrictions could include curbs on lending and deposit. So if the Reserve Bank of India is putting restrictions on the bank, that it cannot lend a lot of money and take deposits, that is a discretionary restriction. That will depend on bank to bank, and that will be under the gray area. But there are mandatory restrictions. If the non-performing assets increase beyond a certain level, then you have to stop the bank from opening new branches. You have to reduce the compensation of the directors. You have to also put restrictions on the profit of the bank. So these are some of the prompt corrective actions. So this was my first video. I hope I was able to explain to you about some of these issues, and this is one of the most important questions that can be asked as an essay, non-performing assets and the solution. And you can also be asked about the twin balance sheet problem. So I hope now you're in a better position to tackle this question. Thanks for watching. Second video will be uploaded tomorrow morning.